Welcome, everyone. Good evening. Thank you for joining us, and thank you to my panelists for being here. We'll get to introductions in a little bit, but I thought we could start by talking about why we're here today. Essentially, a government committee has published a report on the regulation of non-personal data. And this is a very landmark report. There's nothing like this anywhere in the world. So it's worth, I think, taking a bit of time to think through the implications of this report. The primary objective of this report is to realize the economic value from the use of non-personal data. We want to essentially create incentives for innovation and promote startups in India through the sharing of non-personal data. That's what the committee says in its report. And we're here today to understand what that impact will be on startups and small businesses. And we have a stellar panel to do just that. We have startup founders, VCs, and policy experts. Leading voices of the industry. And I'm your moderator for the session. I'm Lan. I lead policy efforts on data and emerging tech for Google in India. Just before we get into the panel itself, I thought, you know, let's just do a quick 2-minute refresher on non-personal data and the report. It's version 2 of the report. Version 1 was released in July, and we had version 2 in December. And we're actually in the middle of a consultation process. Comments are due by the end of this month. So what is non-personal data? Essentially, we're dealing with all data that is not personally identifiable. And as you can imagine, that's very broad universe. This is, you know, anonymized data at source, but also, you know, through anonymization technologies. And there's also data that does not involve humans. So you would imagine machine data would be part of this universe. So really, we're dealing with broad universe of data, right? So going back to why this is such a landmark report and what's discussing right now. Just very quickly to go into, you know, 5 or 6 highlights of what the committee is recommending. Essentially, they're asking for a law, a national law that would regulate non-personal data. And they're also calling for a national, for a non-personal data authority to be established. So another regulator to recommend. Importantly, I think there is this idea of data sharing, which is central to this report. And there's been some progress, I think, from earlier versions of the report. Essentially, now what the committee has said is that businesses will not be required to share data with another company, but requests for data sharing can be made for public good purposes. And we'll get into that in a little bit. They also have this requirement for registration of data businesses, and we'll get into that as well. Essentially, these are businesses that deal with data above a certain threshold. And, you know, these are things like user base and, you know, percentage of revenue that comes from data. And clearly that's a compliance requirement that, you know, at some point all businesses might have to comply with. So we'll get into that as well. There's also this idea of high value data sets. I think this has come from the committee on the basis of saying, look, this universe of non-personal data you're dealing with is just too broad. Let's talk about what really the objective is and what you're trying to solve for. And they've come up with this idea of HVDs, high value data sets, which are essentially data sets that are beneficial to the community at large. And they've given the example of things like the transport sector, the healthcare sector. And that's really what we're going to be discussing today. And I think the last thing is another kind of improvement in the report is that they're talking about now very narrow data requests, data sharing requests that can be made. I think an important point is, yet, is that they've excluded proprietary data sets from the scope of data sharing request. So, you know, no proprietary information, no inferred data sets, no derived data sets. They're all outside the scope of data sharing. So again, we're really dealing with a narrow data set essentially. But I think what we're here to discuss is, with all of this said, do we still need a version 3? It seems like there's a lot still left to be discussed. And, you know, that's why we're here today. With that, I'm very happy to introduce the panel. Like I said, we have just experts, the leading voices from startup founders, the investor community, and, you know, public policy experts that deal with these subjects from day to day. We have Deepa, who's the CEO at Nlenso. We have Ashish, who heads policy at NASSCOM. We have Kumar, who's the CEO of Slang Labs. Prashanto, who's a public policy consultant. Sameer Verma, who's managing director at Nexus Venture Partners. And Rajan, who's a partner at Upekha. We'll also be joined by Shweta, who's head of policy at Sequoia Capital. So very quickly, the three themes that we're going to be discussing today that we thought could be the focus of this discussion. The first one is really taking a step back and starting from first principles, right? What are the justifications for regulating non-personal data, right? From an economic perspective, a social perspective, you know, what's the moral justification for this? The second theme is to deal with the trade-offs involved, right? An assessment of essentially what the cost and benefit is. And this is where we'll get into perhaps some of the issues around compliance. And the last is actually the regulatory modalities that the committee has recommended and what the panel feels about what's been proposed here. In terms of the flow, we're going to get into each of these themes one by one. We'll have 15 minutes for each of these themes, and we'll leave plenty of time for Q&A. We'll take questions right at the end, but please keep your questions coming. We'll take them both from Zoom and YouTube at the end. We do intend to wrap up with some key takeaways so that the committee has something to go by. So with that, getting right into the discussion, I'd like to start with you, Deepa, if we can, on this question of the justification for regulating non-personal data. And really, I think one of the fundamental premises of this new report is that raw data or factual data can generate economic value if shared. So where does raw data lie in this value stream? You know, as a data scientist, we're really curious to know, you know, how do you think about raw data? And what are the incentives, if any, for businesses to share this raw data with others, given the costs of collection and storage of raw data?
Sure. Thanks, Amdan. So before I respond specifically to this question, I do want to point out that, like you mentioned earlier, the framework in its current form at least focuses on public good rather than economic value creation as an end in itself. And maybe this is because the framework has undergone multiple revisions, and so it's come to prioritize social good now over data sharing or economic value creation. So coming to the question of raw data, I do think that data custodians or businesses don't necessarily have an incentive to analyze their data sets in the same way that someone on the outside would or could. Clearly, they obviously don't combine the raw data sets either. So just to give you an example, Strava is an application that many of us use. Runners and cyclists use it to track, you know, their activities. Say all cyclists are slowing down on a particular stretch of road, or all cyclists are slowing down on a particular stretch of road when it rains, which is indicative of waterlogging. Now, this is not necessarily something that Strava cares about or can even do anything about, but it's something that a public body might find useful and might be able to act upon. And for what it's worth, companies like Strava already share data with the government. So it's not just an economic incentive that they need, but obviously the data sets that are available are less robust. Not all companies are doing this, and this data is only available to the government and so on and so forth. So there is potential in raw data. I don't know about value yet, right? And coming to the cost of making this possible, so first of all, companies are already collecting and storing data, so I don't know if, if that is necessarily what they care about. The question is really, what harm can it do to a business that has gone into, you know, taken this effort of collecting this data for, you know, its own use? And any data, including metadata, can reveal a lot about, the strategic direction in which a company is moving and so on. And that can, that is, I think, the major concern that companies have today. But otherwise, you know, one way to think about it is that this is like your CSR obligation or a tax that large companies have to bear for the greater common good, you know. So it much depends on how this is implemented and what, you know, how it eventually pans out.
Great. No, thank you, Deepa. I think two points that you said is something I want to pick up on. One is this idea of the justification seems to be social impact, you know, social good. And if I can, Kumar, I'd like to come to you for a question on that subject. Right? The recommendations talk about this public good purpose, and there's a lot of question about a discussion about whether that's very broad definition, whether we have a good understanding of what that means. But, you know, let's take a hypothetical example and in a sector that you deal with. So assume the policy objective is increasing language diversity, something obviously relevant to India. Would mandating the sharing of something like, you know, NLP datasets help achieve that goal? And if not, what do you think is the right approach?
Sure. Hey, thanks for asking this. Great question. So our personal belief is, like, I think sharing of data is useful, because when we started out, we had the exact same problem, right? We were looking for such data sets to be able to now train our models, to be able to now build out language training. Like, there are a bunch of popular data sets available in the market, but they're very limited. Especially in India, we don't get so many, and then they're all hidden in some places. So the notion of sharing these data sets for public good, especially for companies to be able to take them and innovate on top, definitely has value. Now, the way to make that incentivize it from a business. So now we are now at a point, like, for example, if you take ourselves as an example, when we started out, we really wanted to be able to now collect this kind of get data from somebody. Now, today we are at a point where we have collected a lot of data. Now, are we going to be incentivized to sharing the same data with somebody else? So if you ask us, like, oh, we're going to suddenly start putting up our, oh, but what is the value in me sharing this data? So to be able to now, but there is definitely people who would be able to now do things more than what we have been able to do with the data that we have collected. But at the same time, to be able to now incentivize us, just like there's a patent system, which sort of gives you a lock-in time for the data that you have collected or your innovation. So if there is a sort of like a lock-in period of the data they have collected, and then I have maximized my initial sense, now I want to make it available for somebody, because there's no point in that sitting in my storage and not adding any more additional value to my system or to anybody else. So I think having that a delayed exposure of data, I think would be a great way for businesses to not lose their initial value, but also for everyone else to maximize on this data that anybody has collected.
No, thank you so much, Kumar. I think you're really spot on. And, you know, I'd love to get some of the investors into this discussion as well, because I think the point you're really talking about is, you know, where that startup is in its business journey, right, in its growth. And Deepa was making this point earlier as well, right, about insights on your strategic direction. So I'd love to get, you know, Samir and others on this question in a little bit. Take on some of these first principle questions, right, really questioning the basis for regulating non-personal data. Deepa mentioned an interesting point, which is that startups already share data. And not just startups, you know, big businesses do this and governments do this too. So if I can just go to Ashish. Ashish, NASSCOM has been on this committee and in part of these deliberations. I'd love to know, what's the evidence of market failure that necessitates, you know, a prescriptive regulatory framework like the committee is proposing? There are already data sharing practices. You know, TensorFlow is a great example of that. You know, there's also examples of language data sets that are available. Is there evidence of market failure? Do we need to be doing this right now?
See, Amlan, not a traditional framework where we look at, you know, a typical market failure, but it's more in terms of, you know, the sum is greater than the parts. So that's really the hypothesis here. And when you put the public policy lens and look at it from a social good perspective, I think the potential of creating a lot of benefit for the society at large using the idea of high value data set, I think that's very promising. So I want to underline the fact that in all of the deliberations of the committee, or in, and even if you read the earlier version and now, especially from a startup perspective, the entire hypothesis is that this will be beneficial to the startups. So at the end of it, when we look at, you know, the report shaping up, if we don't see that benefit, then I think that's something that we should worry about. And what I've heard till now also in the panel, I think what Deepa mentioned, that's fairly accurate. I think while tax could be some kind of a negative analogy, but that's what it is in some sense, you know, that you're already invested in a certain business, you're doing certain things. And if the now, and if you take that analogy to say that, you know, rivers flowing into the ocean. So it is really the value of that ocean and what is it that we can do with that? And that's really promising. So from a policy perspective, if you also put the dots with AI and to say that, you know, what is it that we can at some point in time do to leverage this kind of a data? I think there are immense possibilities, and that's really promising. So I wouldn't look at it from a narrow sense that there is a particular failure. I think where we are at in the entire, you know, timeline of data sharing, I think we are at very early stages. I think the examples which you mentioned, or even other examples, so these are very small pockets of examples that we are really dealing with. So that's where I would think that there's a huge potential.
Right. No, fair point. I do want to touch on one other, I think, fundamental principle that is guiding both the discussion on NPD, but primarily the data protection bill, and that's this idea of consent. So Prashanthu, I'd love to get you in on this question. If you can talk a little bit about how, you know, the committee's thinking through this idea of consent as it applies to non-personal data, and if you can juxtapose that with this idea of anonymization and its recommendation from the committee that users should be allowed to opt out of anonymization. What do you think this does for, you know, incentives for, you know, an engineer trying to build a product where essentially you have to now create a system where users can opt out of anonymization? Love to hear you talk a little bit about that.
So great point. I'd just like to start by stepping a little wider. And, you know, I think in terms of the question of the purpose, so public good, now clearly public good is a can be a fuzzy concept. It needs to be sharpened and defined more clearly. And I'd like to just say to, you know, Deepa's point about possible harm to business, the fact is there can be harms in the public good context too. And so that's just a short comment I'd just like to leave before jumping to the anonymization thing, that we've discussed this on, there was a Medianama discussion on this where this point also came up, that if you have metadata, which by the way can be much more valuable and potential for abuse, etc., than the actual data. If you have metadata on, say, Swiggy or Zomato and their food supplies, and you know, and you start looking at the aggregated metadata of red meat consumption in different districts, okay, now that could be for public good for health reasons. It could be misused. You know, which are the areas which are ordering beef and pork, etc., and it could be seriously misused if that aggregated data. So it's not personal data. There's no personal issue there. That is the first part. But I think that, as well as this anonymization thing you brought up, is reflective of, this question of, did we really need this, or is this addressable by various other regulations? Like in tech, you have so much of regulation there, including on data sharing with the public regulator, with the regulator in context. With anonymization, I think that's a very major one. And that's, I just cannot figure why this has still been retained in draft two. Anonymization is being discouraged here. They are saying you need to have consent for non-personal data, personal data to be anonymized, with an opt-out being allowed. So this is like saying that, okay, you enter your passwords. Now, if you want to encrypt those passwords, you should take consent from the user to encrypt those passwords. The anonymization is, it's a step which is taken. So for example, fintechs, when they gather personal data, and then they want to analyze that for analytics, for fraud scores, a whole lot of aggregated analytics, they would absolutely want to anonymize that for safety. Now, suddenly we are putting a barrier here saying that, no, you cannot do that without consent. And so you must retain. And by the way, very often this kind of analytics is done by third parties. And so therefore, an entity like Visa or Amex or whatever would simply not want to give its personal databases to those third parties without anonymizing them. Now we are telling them that they can't. So why, for analytics, for a whole bunch of other reasons that you want to use this aggregated data, is there an additional barrier? I think that's
Thank you, Prashanthu. I think several good points there. We'll come back to some of these ideas, especially the point on metadata. I do want to come back to that. But if I can just go to Samir and Rajan, right? So Samir, starting with you, I think there are two points. I think the audience will be really curious to know what the VC, the investor perspective on this is. The theme that came out from both what Ashish and Deepa said was this idea that maybe this is a tax, maybe this is a fine that data businesses have to pay to do business in India. And this wouldn't be the first example of a compliance-based, you know, regulation. So I'm just wondering if you share this view that at some point in time, every business will be a data business. And then if that's the case, given some of these requirements around mandatory registration of data businesses, should we just accept the fact that, you know, compliance with data regulations of this sort is a cost doing business in India?
So at least, yeah, thanks for that. The way I look at it is, just talking from a capitalistic and investor standpoint, investors hate uncertainty when they're making an investment, right? And when we're investing into startups, these are companies which are in search of a business model. So there are all kinds of risks thrown out there, especially in the early stages, right? What we want is, or what any startup or any entrepreneur would want, is absolutely good and clear regulation and less overhead when you're building out the company, right? So that is absolutely a given, right? And what we've always been as investors wary of is when there's a lack of clarity, from the government on policy or regulation. I think that can be a big disruptive force because the government could be breathing down your neck and not give you the requisite clarity when you're building out something. And while you think that you've achieved product market fit and you've got some bit of competitive advantage or things like that, that moat that you would have built with data and powering your business could suddenly be thrown open with some kind of regulation. So I think as you're thinking about this, I'm glad this is in version 2, and we'll probably see another version and an implementation in the next 18 months. Our only request to regulators and all of us here is that we should emerge with a paradigm of giving certainty to businesses so that it is a level playing field in some ways, but it is not putting anybody at a disadvantage or the other. And the other thing is, whether it's a tax, I think tax can work well when it's tangible, right? If you look at telecoms, they had a USO obligation fund, for example. It was very tangible. Anybody who made money put money into that, into the thing. And, there was a tangible way in which things worked, right? I think the challenge here is going to be, if that tangibility framework can be put in some ways that it brings in a level playing field. And, that might not be the case. And I think, going back to the points on anonymization and metadata, I think those are, specifically on the metadata front, I think I'm not an expert, but, that can really disrupt the level playing field and take away any kind of competitive advantage that any company would have had. So I think those, you have to tread very carefully on that. And most importantly, on some of these issues, the industry has to consult very closely with the government, because to be honest, the government might not be able to understand the nuances around some of these newer businesses. So I think we have to be very, very careful when it comes to, the government also having a framework for doing this in a very objective and a very tangible and a very clear way. So that's what I would say at a very, very high level, and reduce the uncertainty, because, you don't want to be, disadvantaging or putting anybody at a disadvantage, but, just making sure that things are set in a very, very clear way. And there's a framework in which all the participants can give feedback and it's clear.
Great. No, thanks, Samir. I'm hearing three things. Level playing field, don't be disruptive, and clarity. Yeah. So I will come back to these themes, but I think we're also coming on the second theme that we were talking about, right? What are the trade-offs? What does this mean for startups? What are the costs that they will have to incur? So Rajan, would love to hear your take on all of these things that we've been talking about, but also this idea of, do we need to just accept the fact that compliance and some of these recommendations are just the cost of doing business?
So to start with, quick comments on the earlier points that you touched upon in terms of themes, right? So why does regulation happen? Regulation happens for three things. Either you're trying to promote innovation or remove the hindrance that has been created towards that. You're trying to improve consumer choices, or you're trying to strengthen government, or in some cases where democracy has been weakened. And what has been seen is technology platforms have become very, very powerful. It can even sort of have sways on how democracy works. And we've seen that, a few weeks ago, and how Twitter was able to censor Trump, right? So that's the reason why regulation gets involved. So in that context, I would say data can be looked at as a source of value, but more than the source of value, when it comes to a business, data is actually a source of moat, source of defensibility. It is not as much as a river coming in or going out of ocean. It is more a fort, right? Many companies, when they become really big, they actually care about data from a perspective of, hey, does it give me defensibility so that another person does not come and get more shares of profit, which is what Kumar was alluding to. So data is better thought of as a moat rather than as a source of value. Of course, it has raw potential value. So on your question about like the tax and the fee, I think we live in a day and age where it is much more easier for us, for anybody to be a billionaire than a millionaire entrepreneur. Or in Indian language terms, I would say it is much more easier for you to be a Mukesh Ambani than an Aam Aadmi founder. Because many of the times when these policies are created, whether it was the NTP or whether it is, you know, related to e-commerce, right, or whether we are talking about the bill that is in discussion, it is always used as a way to make the rich more richer. And then the smaller guy who's trying to do the innovation, he kind of gets edged out. So in that sense, right, what I would say is that, like, you know, however the bill has been framed, however the report has been framed, you need to have a special consideration for, hey, is it going to help the small businesses or the startups? Is it going to promote innovation? And there are multiple stakeholders. There is a government, there is a big incumbent, there is a citizen, and there is a startup or an entrepreneur which is trying to do innovation. And that's what you'll talk about from a trade-off perspective. So for a business, you can think about it as an additional tax. I love the point that Samir said, right? You know, you don't want to introduce another uncertainty. Another uncertainty an Ambani can deal with, but a small startup cannot deal with. So you have to make it really, really simple for him. But one of the interesting thing about data as a business is that, you know, when you think about every business becomes a data business, that means that every business becomes global business. Now, if you're going to introduce more and more complications, right, you have to keep in mind that, you know, the entrepreneurs will go to the place where there is least amount of friction. And we have seen this happen across cities where now startups are flocking away from San Francisco and moving to Miami, right? You will see a lot of countries then say, hey, here is a much better, easier framework for you to do. Of course, so then the question really to ask is, when Google comes and plays in India and a startup here like Kumar is playing against Google in India, what is the rules of the game and how is it stacked? So I would rather say that for India, it should be thought of as a fee to play the game. And if you're increasing the fee, then, like, you know, just keep the small guy in mind. But then he's also playing a global game. And if the fee is going to be really, really high, he will move away to somewhere else where the fee is not as high.
Okay. No, thank you, Rajan. Really good points. I'm going to come back to a couple of the things you mentioned, especially this point about fee to play the game. And I want to get both Samir and you to weigh in on that idea. Before we get into that, I think just sticking with this idea of trade-offs, right? There was the point that Prashanthu made earlier on metadata, which I do want to come back to in the context of trade-offs. And Kumar, it'd be great if you can weigh in on this. So with metadata, clearly the committee believes there is, again, some inherent value to this. They're proposing a public directory of metadata based on certain predefined fields that every company data business would have to input into. Can you talk a little bit about what you think the value of this, the utility of this could be? And as Prashanthu mentioned, clearly there are some privacy and security implications of this. So what's the best way of evaluating these trade-offs? And in this particular case of metadata, what's your view?
Thanks. So I think for me personally, it is like about what is your starting point? Right? My starting point, I like to be able to, like, look, we want to be able to know, share this. I think there is value in sharing, but there is a problem in the privacy and there's a problem that will come with sharing. So we have to figure out a way to solve the problem and not start with, oh, there is a problem, let's not share. So I think the first object in my mind, I think sharing makes sense, right, of this metadata. And because a structured metadata sharing modality will definitely help. Again, like I was saying, like when we started, we were scouting and scrambling for ability for us to be able to look at structured data. It was all over the place. There was no centralized place to be able to now collect all this data. So if there is some way in which things could be available in a more structured format that we could consume, I think value creation will certainly happen. So I think there is no doubt about it. I think the challenge, like a lot of other people have also mentioned, is like the privacy concerns that is there. Like when you want to be able to know anonymized data, for example, NLP data sets, let's take an example of NLP data sets. How do you anonymize? Like when somebody is now speaking and you want to transcribe that data, and that is data set. Right? Somebody spoke and then you want the WAV file and then you have now collected the text that person has now spoken. Now, as a company, we try to anonymize data because what somebody could have spoken could contain personally identifiable information. Right? Now, there are a lot of attempts that we do to be able to now scrub out that data when we store them and when we use them for training. Now, but this is not a foolproof system of when we now try to scrub that data. Right? But then we have additional mechanisms as a company to be able to now safeguard, making sure nobody except the machine can look at the data. Nobody has access to look at the actual raw text that somebody has actually spoken. It's only a machine that can look at, there is no way. Now, but we're now sharing this data outside to somebody else. Now, who now safeguards the data that you have now collected on behalf of a customer. Right? Now, because it's now outside us, even though we think we have anonymized it, there is always a chance that it can be re-anonymized because there could have been something that we had missed in the original anonymization. So that mechanism of what is the standardization of anonymization because of the technical limitations that exist, how do we now safeguard it? So that is, I think, is a concern. In theory, it can be worked out, but I think there is still, there are a bunch of unknowns there. But if you step back and say, should we try to solve it? Should we not even try to solve it? I think we should try to solve it. We should share data. We should have the directory of ability for people to share, but we need to be able to now figure out a better way to anonymize and better way to now make sure this data that we're sharing is not reversible.
Great. Thanks, Kumar. You know, it's a good panel when people disagree, and I like that we've already reached a point of disagreement. So great. I think the other point I did want to make for, you know, panelists and the audience is we do have members of the committee of experts who are listening in on this. So it'd be great if, you know, as you talk about these issues, you can talk about, you know, specific recommendations you want to make. You know, we're really happy to have them be listening in on this. Shweta, I leave you here on this panel. So thank you for joining us. Shweta is the head of policy at Sequoia Capital. I want to bring you in on two questions. The earlier question that, you know, Sameer and Rajan were commenting on, this idea of, you know, compliance. And for someone who's been working in the public policy space for so long, you know, there's this idea of ease of doing business that the government really likes to talk about. So given some of what we're seeing in the data protection bill and non-personal data, what do you think this does for, you know, ease of doing business in India? So that's the first question. And you can talk to some of the other themes we've seen come out of that. And the second question I do want to get you in on is, I think if we take a step back, we also realize that this is a regulation, a framework that also applies to the government. And I don't want to lose sight of that. So it'd be great if we can talk a little bit about what that means for both the investor community and the startup community. Do you think we should be looking at this idea of, you know, unlocking this value of data in that that's currently with the government? And I believe that there's potentially a lot of social benefits and value to be unlocked there. So should we be thinking about incentives and, you know, these justifications for data sharing differently in the context of government data?
Well, all very interesting points, Amlan, and thank you so much. Apologies, firstly, everyone, for being late here. But I think I want to go back, and I'm not sure if we discussed this at all, but I want to go back to the entire premise of governing non-personal data, because I can tell you that as investors and large investors in this current ecosystem, we've been having conversations with startups across, you know, startups that are well-advanced, unicorns, startups that are starting out in our seed stage. And we've been trying to understand what this non-personal data framework can mean for the startup ecosystem. And first and foremost, I think most startups are unaware of the implications of this. So I think it comes as a shocker to them when we try and help them understand that this is something that is being talked about and proposed, and they find it very hard to digest. So what I can tell you is that if you're going to send out an email or a survey to startups and try and help them answer those questions, for them, the whole concept of data sharing is all about the way, say, a Niti Aayog DEPA is trying to do data sharing, which is very different from what a non-personal data governance framework is trying to put in place. So I think first and foremost, I'd like to reiterate the point that startups are absolutely unaware of the implications of what this can do. For those who have done a deeper dive and have understood this, the one answer that we get from everybody is that this is going to kill and finish innovation. Absolutely. I mean, the whole competitive advantage, Amlan, for any startup today is the fact that they derive value from that data. And the whole idea of that, collecting that data and monetizing it or doing whatever they'd like to do in terms of their algorithms or anything, is the whole notion of the digital economy, is the whole notion of innovation. That's the bedrock of innovation. And suddenly you're being told, you know what, one fine day you'll be asked to part away with that data, anonymized or non-anonymized, personal or possible of, you know, those are, yes, we understand that we're trying to say that this is going to be data that will be anonymized, it's going to be used for policymaking, it will be used for community purposes. But it's very hard to tell a founder today who has spent his years of, you know, blood, sweat, you know, to try and build a startup to say, you know what, hand it over. So I think that concept itself is not something that startups are able to fathom at this point in time. You know, I think, and what's ironical is that the whole premise of the non-personal data framework was based on this being a way to help the startup ecosystem. So I think we just need to go back to the drawing board and say, do we need this framework? And I understand that the committee has worked very hard. I understand that the committee has brought about some very, very important changes and some very relevant and good changes, whether it is in terms of data processors not being obligated. All of those changes are very welcome. But I do think that we still, as a country that is today got the third largest startup ecosystem in the world, a country that is talking about 100 unicorns by 2025, a country that can today become the most innovative country on the planet. Now, when we're looking at those kind of tall, big goals and ambitions, do we need to bring in this non-personal data framework and upset the regulatory architecture in a way that it will spook investors? It's going to cause regulatory uncertainty and it's going to add to the compliance burden of startups and completely kill innovation. So I just think, I know it may sound strong, but I still think there's a lot of rethinking we need to do around it. Now, having said that, when we're moving forward to what you're saying, I think any amount of data sharing when we talk about has to come at a stage where we first have a personal data protection law in place. And we have seen it, function in its letter and spirit for a few years to understand how that is happening. So we're at a stage in our data governance as well as tech policy where the country does not have a data protection law. And that should be the overarching regulation that we should look at. And not only look at a data protection regulator coming in place as the bill suggests, putting in place rules and regulations, trying to understand how that process will work, I think itself is a huge task that the entire tech industry, the government, policymakers have in front of them. In the midst of this, if we come up with a separate exercise and try to do something which no other country in the world has done, I think we're just causing so much confusion in the minds of startups that are just looking for ease of doing business, as you said. They're just looking for regulatory certainty. They just want an environment where they can thrive and flourish and have minimum governance, minimum regulation, or at least regulation where they're expected to. I mean, nobody's against a privacy law. Everybody thinks there should be privacy. So I think that itself is something that startups are so worried about right now that they just can't even imagine that these are the kind of compliance and regulatory burdens they'll have to face. Registering as a data business, being answerable to a non-personal data regulator, trying to give out data sets. So I know I've given a rather long answer to your question, but I'll pause here and say that let's please, before we get down to saying what is the best way to govern non-personal data, let's just go back and keep questioning, do we really need to?
Shweta, we hear you loud and clear. I think very emphatic. This is not good for startups, right? And I think the other point you mentioned is we're currently in the midst of a debate on the data protection bill that's been in the works for longer than the non-personal data bill. I think there is a point of discussion to be had on what a data protection bill that incorporates elements of non-personal data would look like, which is what it seems like the JPC is going down that path, but maybe we'll come back to that. I do want to touch on the one big theme that came out over the last 15 minutes or so, which is this issue of competitive advantage. And Sameer and Rajan, if I can get you back to discuss this question. I think really interesting point of discussion here, right? And this touches on, again, issues of trade-offs, but also the way in which the government is thinking about regulating it to help promote startups. From your perspective as an investor, do you see non-personal data regulation as a loss of competitive advantage, which seems to be clearly something that a lot of investors believe in? But at the same time, I also heard from folks like Kumar that perhaps it helps reduce barriers to entry in new markets. So if there is data sharing, you get access to this data, and perhaps you can get into a market that already has an established player. So two sides of the coin, how do you see this playing out? If I can start with Rajan, and Sameer, I'll come to you next.
Yeah, I think the loss of competitive advantage is a good question, but the question is for whom? Right? Is it a loss of competitive advantage for incumbent or it is for the startup? Right? In this regulation discussion, right? And I've referred to things like the e-commerce policy or previously the telecom related policy. It was all towards the incumbent or the ones that who could pull the money to sort of set up the business, right? So today, whoever has become really really big, they treat that as a competitive advantage and they don't want to lose it, but the bill or any of the suggestion that we are looking at should be making it easy for a startup And then there is many precedents to this, not just in India, but across the world. AT&T was broke up. Before that, you know, the pharma industry in the US, they had a bill which, again, you know, broke down the entire pharma industry. The monopolies were reduced. So most of the times when we talk about regulation, it is for making sure that there are no monopolies that are getting created other than the natural monopolies that exist, right? So competitive advantage for big companies, data, they want to protect it and they would want to sort of go forward and say, hey, no, don't do it. But competitive advantage for startup is what one should be looking at. And if we are talking about a framework, then we have to make sure that, you know, it is friendly towards the startup. It increases competition, but doesn't create doesn't allow an incumbent to erect more barriers. So it's for whom is the question.
For whom is the question? Yeah, I think heard this a couple of times in your comments, and Shweta alluded to this as well. The committee's objectives clearly are to promote startups. So let's hear the startups out in terms of what the committee is trying to do. Sameer, would love to hear your views on this, and then we can get to some of the founders as well for their perspective on this.
Sure. No, I think it is imperative that, you know, in today's time and age, the government really understands what they're trying to get into, right? I think all the big tech that has been created has been created because of capitalistic forces. I agree with it. And that it wouldn't have been created if the system of capitalism didn't work, right? And in many ways, they have taken a good, they're just free, and there's customer data. And I agree with is it right now? I don't know if that's the case, right? Clearly, but that has created great platforms, and it is where the customer data is the person is the customer in some ways, and the data of that person is what is being sold, right? I think the first step, as you know, even Shweta alluded to, is that we need to have a strong privacy law in the country, and that should be the bedrock on which a lot of this needs to happen. I think the government is trying to attack this problem in too many ways without really understanding a lot of the nuances under the hood, right? As far as PII is concerned, or anonymization is concerned, these are deeply hard technical problems to solve. And I've had the good fortune, unfortunately or fortunately, to have studied and looked at a lot of companies in this space. I can tell you it's really, really hard to do, right? It's you can re-identify people with a bit of metadata here and a bit of data here or there, right? So I think this needs a very comprehensive understanding of the problem. And I think, it's not to solve it in bits and pieces, right? It is that the government really needs to think about the Privacy Act first, or the Privacy Data Law first, and putting the customer or the user in control first, and then, have a framework for solving this, which is not peripheral, but not, that should not come first in many ways, because this would, it's a flare in some ways that, can tilt the balance in the favor of incumbents or crony capitalists or people who can enter the thing late by not understanding it in a very comprehensive way. So that's what I would say, that it really needs to be thought through well. My discomfort stems from the fact that I'm not very sure whether the government really understands this in a very, very comprehensive manner. And, it might set a wrong precedence when it comes to the major 800-pound gorilla in the room, which is the privacy law. I think you should solve that first, put the user in control, and that should be the framework. And that's the right framework by which you can deal with, the big tech and who needs to be monetized in this equation, rather than a small flare of this, which would set the wrong precedents and set the wrong ball rolling, and you would have a disadvantageous privacy law coming down the road. So that's what I would say. It's a complicated answer, but it's a very complicated question as well. So,
Sure, no, but I think there's one clear message that that I hear, that in terms of the timing of this, premature for sure. We need to have a privacy law. Perhaps there are some learnings from there that we can apply to this. So definitely very clear message.
It's putting the user in control. I think you can't go wrong with that. I think that's the you're going to solve it from there. And I think that's the best way to do it worldwide. It's not only in India. I think that will be something which will happen worldwide. I think we should focus on that first.
Got it. So Prashanto, Ashish, I want to come to you on a couple of questions. But just before that, I'd love to hear from the founders as well. So Deepak, we can start with you on some of the themes we've heard of the last 10 minutes, but especially this idea of, you know, loss of competitive advantage versus potentially gaining access to data and then being able to enter into market for a new product vertical.
Yeah, so I think Kumar made a really good point about barriers to entry, right? So there's certainly something to be said about making data sets available for people to use as training sets and things like that. And we've seen really effective sort of product innovation come from that. As a user, since the user is not represented on the panel, I can say that I'm not so keen on companies owning my data just because they've given me a product that I can use either, right? So I definitely agree with the sentiment of putting the user at the center of any regulation on data, which is not what exists currently. So I think that, you know, there is a balance to be struck also in terms of allaying the fears of new startups that they will be burdened with, you know, compliance and things like that. A lot of this can be addressed by setting appropriate thresholds as to whom this legislation would actually apply to and whom it would not, and who can actually take on the burden of this. So perhaps all startups don't need to be so concerned about it as well.
Got it. So thanks, Deepa. So again, this idea that, you know, users should be at the center of it, and perhaps something to look at this report again from the perspective of the user. Kumar, your thoughts before I go to Ashish and Prashanto.
Yeah. So thanks. At the risk of Shweta never funding my company, so I'm going to disagree to. So I think there is this notion that like data is a new oil, and so there that bird has become so popular that like everyone wants to keep saying, man, if I lose data, I'm going to lose oil. It's literally being equated to the literal oil field of the past, because just because I have oil, I can literally become Ambani, because just there is nothing, no unknowns to that later, right? My oil is to give me money. But today, data will not give you innovation, right? If I'm willing to bet, if Swiggy lost all its metadata, you can't build another Swiggy. It's not possible. It's not just the fact that there's a bunch of operational things that you're willing to do. There's a bunch of innovation that you have to do on top of what you do with the data. So today, if you give me the entire voice data set, like when I just become the world's best voice assistant, no, it's not possible. There's still a lot more that has to happen on top of that. This is the starting enabling point. It just levels some level of the enabling point. Okay, people who are interested to be able to now start this journey, let's give them the ability to now do it, because without this, you can't even start the journey in the current frame of how we are operating. So you need to be able to give them. Yes, there is a lot of risk. No, there's a lot of unknowns about it. Like the fact that, okay, what is anonymization? How do I supposed to share? At what threshold am I supposed to give? All that is a given. There is no doubts about that. That the assumption is that will get solved. And that's where the people like us are debating and then trying to come back to the government and trying to give them better inputs to be able to solve it. But at a conceptual level, should it be even thought about or not be thought about? I think the thing is, like, I think it has to be thought about, and I don't think it is going to defeat competitors in its raw thing. And there's a lot more to competitors just as the raw data that people are providing. And I think, like, you're like the Swiggy's founder and so many other people have done brilliant unicorns. I think it is not just in the facts of their science that the data they're given, there's so much more to it.
Okay, thanks, Kumar. No, I think there's definitely a point there on, you know, data and what that value is. Again, you know, to get the investor perspective on whether valuations are based on data, I think would be interesting discussion. But I know we're running out of time. I do want to get to audience questions. So Prashanto, I'll come to you first and then Ashish. Prashanto, you've worked in the fintech sector now for a very long time. And I think the committee has a very interesting recommendation when it comes to the role of sectoral regulators. It says that, you know, a sectoral regulator, let's say the RBI, can develop NPD regulations that go beyond what the central NPD authority would do. What do you make of this? There's obviously the possibility for, you know, conflict and, you know, this regulatory uncertainty that, you know, Shweta and Samir have been talking about. At the same time, do you believe that their expertise can be utilized here? So what's your sense of how sectoral regulators can play a role in, you know, facilitating access to, you know, HPDs?
So, you know, I believe the sectoral regulator in the case of fintech, for example, or several of them, but the RBI predominantly and Debian and others, they're very strong and they need to be. The National Cybersecurity Council defines fintech, the whole BFSI space, as a critical infrastructure area and the good reason. And so therefore, the RBI has a very strong set of norms on data protection, the equivalent of privacy in that space, and sharing of data. It requires a certain flow of data on a regular basis, including a fair bit of daily data. Okay, and I think this is an example of where you're really looking for a solution. Because in multiple cases, now, for example, in the earlier case, you were talking about in metadata, this whole case of competitive advantage, et cetera. And there is a strong case and which has been made, you know, for example, in favor of the NPD authority, et cetera, and forced data sharing, which is like something like Amazon, which has access to a great deal of metadata on what sells. And therefore, it can transfer that to an Amazon Basics or something like that. But it's an antitrust case. And that case is going to be tackled in two places. One is the CCI. And the other one is in the next few days, there's going to be a press note, something or the other from DPIIT, which will probably knock that whole thing off of invest. So what I'm saying is most of the problems that are being stated can actually be tackled by either sectoral regulators or CCI or DPIIT with the Ministry of Commerce.
No, thanks, Prashanto. Really, I think appreciate your expertise and insights here. I think, again, this will be one of those evolving processes. We'll have to see how different sectoral regulators overlap. Ashish, I want to come to you for a final set of questions. One is this idea, again, of how we can look at what the committee has suggested in a positive light, perhaps. So there are obviously some interesting governance principles, including, for example, this idea of interoperability at making data more accessible. And I think that's definitely something that is an aspirational concept that is worth incorporating, perhaps even in existing data sharing practices. Love to get your views on that. And if you could talk a little bit looking forward to what this final report could look like. And I think it seems from the discussion here that we are not ready for a final report. We definitely need a version 3, but what should that version 3 look like?
Thanks.
And then, we'll get to audience questions right after that. So we have a couple of questions, but please keep your questions coming. We'll take them right after. Yeah, over to you, Ashish.
And so just listening into the discussion till now, I think one of the things which we should take back as a message both to the startups and the ecosystem at large is that per se, it doesn't mean that every startup will be required to share any data whatsoever. What it is simply saying is that once a high value data set is created and there are particular startups who could potentially contribute to that high value data set, then those startups would be asked to contribute to that data set. And it will be ensured that no proprietary business productivity linked internal processes linked information is shared. So that's where it is when it comes to startup being asked to share data, and they will not pay you for the data that you have collected, but they will pay you for any effort that is required for that anonymization processing or sharing aspect of that data. So I think it's a very limited context where some startup might end up being asked to share a data. So that's, I think, the first thing which I wanted to just kind of highlight in terms of what is there in the report. I think the thing which is to respond to Samir and about uncertainty, this is a very evolving area and very new area. So the fact that there is uncertainty when you talk about non-personal data is a given. So I think that's just the way it is at present. And I think the PDP bill has anyway put the consumer at the center. And I think NPD report has in a kind of a wrong way has put the consumer in the center by putting the consent for anonymization. So I think that actually puts the consumer in the center in a wrong way. But having made that point, I think what is required next? So I think the role of the data trustee needs to be carved out a little more clearly, because it is the data trustee who will handle the high value data set and who will make demands on sharing of the data. So what is the eligibility of this data trustee? I think that needs to be, there is some English there in the report and there are some principles mentioned. But I think that needs to be carved out a little bit. And I think finally, what will really help is to take the discussion forward is that if the now committee can do the hard work after having done all the work which they've already put in, to actually think in terms of a draft legislation, if that's what we are heading for, and really, you know, put that out for consultation and discussion, because that will really give us a little more clarity on how this is expected to play out. Otherwise, we are looking at a report and we are trying to imagine the things as they will move forward. I think finally, by the look of it, it is going to be a law. So if it is going to be a law, then I think submitting a report and then expecting a law to emerge out of some other quarters, I think that's a big jump. So I would think that just like the PDP bill, maybe invite more experts into the committee and actually think through a draft and consult on that draft. I think that will really give a lot of understanding on where we are actually headed.
Yeah, no, thanks, Ashish. Really appreciate it. I think just looking ahead, and clearly there are lots of unaddressed questions. And in fact, I'm looking at some of the questions from the audience. I already have one, which is, again, a very fundamental question, but happy to hear the panelists respond to this, but I have one as well, right? So from the audience, we have a question on, how would the government know what data to ask for, right? And again, this process of operationalizing this, implementing this, how is this data going to be transferred to them? And my question again would be, who decides what's proprietary, what's inferred, what's derived data, what falls outside the scope of this? Because there's again going to be potentially a conflict there. And I think the incentives are misaligned. So anybody from the panel would like to weigh in on that?
So I can have a quick go at it, Amlan. So I think the first bit is clearly flowing from the public policy public good hat. I think what the committee in the report has given is three examples. One relates to the transportation sector, and the two relates to health. So I think that's directionally, I think that's what we can look at, that they will identify a few specific themes, and that's where they will initially start building this high value data set. And that's when the data trustee will start asking the, in terms of, that's where the request for data will come in. And to your second question, I think it's a very important point, this entire determination of, what is proprietary or not, I think it's in two parts. So one part is where an entity probably, refuses to share data, believing that that data is not relevant for high value data set. I think that dispute probably, from my understanding of the report, will go to the NPD authority. But when, if I make a claim that this is proprietary, I think that will take the usual, process of courts and which is outside of NPDA, to actually settle the matter there if there is actually a dispute on that account, and which could be a very bad place to be in, because then you might, depending on how it goes, one could go well, but the other way is where it could actually lead to a lot of litigation where people are splitting hair on this particular aspect, and I don't think we have the capacity to deal with that.
That's helpful, Ashish. I think definitely seems like we have a lot of thinking left to do and a lot of, I think, open answers. I think before we wrap up, there are two things I want to do. One is, again, we have Rahul Mathan, who has helped in the preparation of this report, who's actually come on to be able to answer some of the questions that have come up during this, I thought, very interesting and insightful discussion. And I think, it's great to have Rahul here. Rahul, I don't know if you can hear me, but if you can, it'd be great to have you talk for about 5 minutes on, some of what we've heard, any responses, and then it'll be great to just kind of wrap up and have something for the committee to think about.
So, this was a great conversation. Really interesting to hear. One of the things that sort of stood out for me was, the difference between the views of the investors and the startups. I thought that was really interesting, because the startups are looking for data, because they're like, look, I want data, this barrier that Shweta spoke about, and I think maybe Samir spoke about as well. I don't know, Prashant, if you spoke about that, but that's the barrier that's keeping them from doing the things they want to do. And investors actually love the barrier, because they've invested in a company. Now they want to keep that company, secure, and they want to keep the barrier. This is the challenge. And, I really like that this thing came out so well in this discussion, because this is sort of really where the challenge is. And, Amlan, you started out saying policy is a trade-off. This is sort of exactly why I want to just go back to that God analogy, Zainab. We all ask God for various things. At the same time, someone is asking God for it to rain, while at the other, in exactly the same time, someone is saying, please don't let it rain because I don't want rain right now. And so in the policymaking process, all the time, someone's going to be unhappy. But I think the reason why these sorts of sessions are good is because we can listen to all of these sort of these different aspects. And then, you know, I am very recently on this side of the panel. In version one, actually was on that side commenting on the report. So it's a bit weird for me. But look, I think all that you know, I'd like to say is that we certainly do listen to all of this, and these inputs are actually very valuable. Couple of responses to some of the questions. Look, I think the way in which the metadata is going to work, I think oops, I just realized I'm not on video. Okay. Ah, there you are. I was talking away, trying to figure out. So the way in which you know, companies are going to access data is essentially through that metadata registry. The idea is, look, if you were to create a high-value data set, where do you start? And once again, if there are better ideas, I think certainly it would be really useful to listen to those ideas. But if you want to start, create a high-value data set, and if we're saying that that is a public good and that we should encourage the creation of that, how do we know what goes into that data set? One way to do that is to say, look, all you companies that collect data, please list the types of data that you collect. And, you know, don't list exactly what it is, but say, look, we collect this sort of data. Then out of that, there would be some person who's thinking completely orthogonally. I think the example that Deepa probably gave of Strava is great. And, you know, you could potentially get that sort of data set through not just Strava, but maybe Strava plus Ola plus Uber plus, you know, the local transport company, whoever's got GPS on their vehicles, and then come up with a data set that says where is their water logging in the city. Now, that is a public good. But how do I know that I can get this public good if I don't know that Strava collects this information, if I don't know that the bus transport company collects this information? And the idea was to keep a registry that you can reference and say, okay, this is the data that's available and this is how we're going to do it. There are challenges, and obviously we don't want to disincentivize companies from creating data sets, because if we do that, then that would really be killing the goose that lays the golden egg. And this is, once again, the balance that has to be arrived at. So if there are better answers to how to do this, absolutely please do send it in. I think, as you noted, the focus of this report has been narrowed to say specifically that it is focusing on public good. I think that was an ambiguity in the previous version, and I hope that that has, by narrowing the scope, has given more clarity and comfort to people. I actually don't like the tax analogy, because, you know, I hate paying taxes. I pay all my taxes, but when I do it, it really hurts. So if there's a better analogy for this, more along the lines of, you know, we're sharing, I like the rivers to the oceans kind of analogy, because we all benefit from the rivers, we all benefit from the oceans. Ideally, that is what has to be done. And we can't dam the rivers. We can't, you know, create a little private lake that we can all use the water for. That's sort of the type of analogy. So I'm going to stop there. I know Zainab is very particular with time, and I'm 1 minute short of your end of time. But really great, glad to have listened to all of this, and thank you all for your inputs.
Thank you, Rahul. Really appreciate that. And essentially, you've done most of my job, which was to bring this all together, have some takeaways. We would have shared this with you and the rest of the committee, but I think you've done a good job of that. I think just to tie up some loose ends, I think this point very early on, right, which is that now public good seems to be the fulcrum around which all of this is going to happen, but that could result in harm. And I don't know if we've thought through them with issues like metadata, but, you know, I think there are lots of other potential use cases, definitely something to think about. This value of data, I think, you know, very early on, there was some discussion about, you know, there's an economic lens you can use to that, there's a social lens, and now, you know, clearly we see even within this panel, investors look at value of data differently, startups look at it, and you know, clearly I think the government and big companies could look at this very differently. So worth looking at it from that perspective as well. I think Shweta made a really good point, which is that are startups even aware of this, the implications of this? How do we make them more aware of what this could mean for them? And I know some of the VCs, the investors in this room, will go back and say, hey, there's something coming you should be watching out for. But I think, you know, folks like Ashish from NASSCOM and perhaps the government needs to, I think, create a little more awareness around this. This issue around regulatory certainty came up, and I think the recommendation there was very clear. We want certainty. Right now, there's this discussion on the data protection bill. We need to have that first, you know, passed, learn from that before we can even think about any regulation on non-personal data. I think that came out very clearly. There's still some fundamental, I think, concepts around even things like, you know, data ownership that came up, which I don't think we have good answers around. So definitely, I think, warrants more discussion and thinking. Really interesting point was around users and where is the user in all of this, right? We started from this assumption that all of what the committee is suggesting is good for startups. And it seems like not entirely the case. And perhaps if we get enough, you know, user groups in this room, we might find that issues that we're proposing, a recommendation we're making on anonymization aren't actually good for users. So I think there's definitely something the committee should think about. And lastly, I just think this idea that there's so many open ends on, you know, how this is going to be implemented and operationalized, that definitely, I think the point was we need to see a version 3 of that get into more detail. So that's it. I really want to thank everyone for staying around for an hour plus on a Friday evening. Really appreciate it. As I said, stellar panel. I learned a lot from this. I know a lot of our audience were seeing comments already. Really appreciate this conversation. And we had Rahul also wrap this up. Thank you again.